Okay, today risk analysis on the program. New way, new form, with incorporation of some of the suggestions I got from you last Thursday. You'll see where it will be in this lecture. We start with a refreshment of the risk identification, just an overview, and then we dig deep down into the risk analysis, the stage that we will start today and we will end it today. And all of the stuff we are going through this afternoon will also be part of the homework assignment. So if you manage to keep up the speed and the paces and the steps we are setting today, you have done quite a lot for delivering your assignment for upcoming Monday. We end up with a short summary and of course the homework. But first, the usual recap. We're still in the big do part, but now we are shifting from the risk identification with the results we got from that stage, and we are going through the risk analysis stage. And finally, next week we'll do the risk evaluation, and then the risk assessment part is over, because next week you learn how to close your risk assessment and do your recommendations towards the organization you are doing the risk assessment for, with measures that can or should be taken. And the official implementation of all the results of your risk assessment is part of the risk treatment, and that's the obligation for the management of the organization to perform, not the duty of the risk assessors. So we're almost there. We came a long way from the context through the identification, and we have two parts to go: the risk analysis and the risk evaluation. It was quite difficult to get a hold of what risk identification is, because as IT-minded people, you have the feeling that risk assessment should only be IT-related. And you came to the conclusion that there is more under the sky than just IT. So risk assessment is the broadest approach you can imagine, with, of course, IT part of the risks to identify. We looked into the assets. Remember, four classes: people, property, proprietary information, and finally the business reputation. And we are only looking into the major assets that contribute to the mission of the organization. By looking into the four classes of assets, we simply drew up first a list, and then we looked into three aspects that are important for our assets. How critical is each asset for carrying out the mission of the organization? What are the consequences if a major asset is lost? And how vulnerable are our assets when we are going to look at threats that might use one or more vulnerabilities? Then we took a look at the threat agents, the groups or individuals, so persons, that might do harm to our valuable assets. And we started drawing up the threat actor list, four classes. You can remember it were the violent criminals, the petty criminals, the economic criminals, and the fourth class, the subversives. And you can put everything under that class if it doesn't fit in the three previous classes. Then we looked per threat actor or threat agent, What are their means, their capabilities? And finally, we took a look into what asset would be of interest for a specific threat actor or threat agent to go in to perform a threat attack. We looked into the threats, and remember there are two types of threats. The human-made with malicious intent, crimes, and the most of the time natural threats, but sometimes they could be initiated by a human, and that group is called the hazards. So we drew up a crimes list and a hazards list. And finally we ended up with trying to establish the relationships between the assets, the threats, the threat agents, and that gave us four beautiful matrices: the asset crimes, the asset hazards, the asset threat actors, and finally the asset threat attacks. And these matrices are going to be used as input for our next step. The most difficult step, because you have to do a lot of calculation. Now we are going to comprehend what is the nature of risk, and specifically what is the level of risk, how high is the level, and should we do something about it or shouldn't we let it be. So the risk analysis. How are we going to proceed from risk identification? We finished, and now going into the risk analysis. Well, we had these beautiful matrices that we built, and the assignment for delivering this morning was try to score them. Try to put a value on each aspect within the assets and within the threat actors and within the threat agents. And your scoring should be either a number 1 or a 3 or a 5 or an 8 or a 10. And these scorings into the matrices are our basis for starting the risk analysis. Before I go into the risk analysis, I saw a lot of people coming in. Too late. But the more souls, the happier the work should be. I saw coming in Dominica. I saw coming in Amit. I saw coming in Enserio. And I saw two more people coming in, but I don't know the names. Ashat. What's your family name? Ashat Bazat. And I saw...
Yes.
Okay, you were announced that you were on your way. Okay. Then I'll switch to how to assess risks, part 4. Only one part to go for next week when we do the stage or the phase risk evaluation. Okay, guys. And ladies, the risk analysis. Four steps to perform. First, we need to understand and describe the risks in question for our specific organization. You know, the Silver Star Mines. We start by determining the risk factors. We need three factors. Then we have to prioritize the risks, because not every risk that you establish has the same priority. Based on the determination of the risk factors and the prioritization, we have to determine what level of risk do we have. And the simplest definition of level of risk is low, medium, high. So the simplest form is a three-level determination. And finally, if you want to, or if your client needs to, you can create a risk register. We'll do step 1, 2, and 3. The first thing we have to do is, in case of determining the risk factors, is understand what risk is and how it is composed. We need to establish three factors, the so-called risk factors. You can say each risk, like this here, has three legs. A leg that's called the probability factor, next the vulnerability factor, and finally the consequences factor. ABC. So we have to build upon the scoring results from the risk identification these three factors. And that's quite a burden to do, because we have to do a lot of calculation, copy-pasting spreadsheets. So the ABC of risk factors. We have our basic data, our basic risk data ready, the scored matrices. The next part is, okay, if we look at all the scored assets, all the scored threat agents, and so on, how do they contribute to the overarching risk for this organization? We can only do that by calculating the risk they produce. So we start with the A, then the B, and finally the C, the probability. When we are going to determine the probability factor, we are going to look into our organization, mainly the assets of our organization, and how likely is it that some idiot threat actor is going to take that asset as a target. So how nice, how lovely, how pleasant is this asset for a threat agent? That gives you the probability factor. After we've done that, we look into the vulnerability. Not every asset is easy to attack or easy to be a target. That depends on the vulnerabilities. The more vulnerable an asset is, the higher the risk of being attacked by a threat agent. And at the end, we look into the consequences. You know that the assets contribute to the mission of the organization, and if an asset is lost, then it will have consequences. And consequences can be more or less severe. And if a threat agent performs a threat attack against an asset using a vulnerability, but it has no consequences, then you don't have a risk. You can have a problem or an incident, but you don't have a security risk. And the greater the consequences, the greater the risk. And we will see that when we do our calculation. So, start with the probability. Be because you liked a to-do list, I introduce by now a to-do list. So the first thing to determine the risk factor is we use as input our basic risk data, you know, the matrices with all your scores. We go through step A, B, and C. Step A, what is the potential probability factor? The output is your probability factor. B, what's the potential output vulnerability? C, potential consequence factor, output. So, based on the input of this processing, you go through these steps in this order, and at the end, you have your potential risk factors. Three, probability, vulnerability, consequences, the PVC. Is this understandable for everybody if I put it in a to-do list like this? That's going in, that's what you have got to do with it, and that should be the result. Because all the three factors I'm building up like this. Okay, we are going to look for an exploitation. What's the likelihood? How could it be exploited when we look at the assets? And what can be the impact of an exploitation of an asset? There we go. The first one, we are going to determine the probability factor. What I need you to do is we are going to, through all the steps, is at least put on your laptop available your scoring spreadsheets. So the scored spreadsheets, have them ready because you have to use it when we are going to perform every single step. So your basic risk data are the spreadsheets you submitted as result of your homework assignment for this morning. The probability factor. We have to determine the likelihood. How likely is it that an exploitation is going to be executed? We have to look into what is called variables. We look into the threats variables, then we look into the target selection variables, and finally we make a probability estimation. And the answer at the end will be okay, for each major asset this will be the possible probability factor. I'll explain first what we are going to do with the threat variables, and then together we are going to perform this step with help of your own spreadsheets. When we want to discover the threat variables, we look into two things: the type of loss events and the type of threat actors and their capabilities, blah 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 blah. What they, as professionalism, have at hand. Type of loss events, that's quite simple. You created the asset crimes matrix, could be empty because you didn't discover any crimes during the past 5 years. It could be the same for the hazards per asset. If you don't have the hazard list made up out of events during the past 5 years, it could be empty. But you did a scoring, so you might have to have an estimation. How likely will it be that this asset will be affected by that type of crime, or how likely will it be that this asset will be influenced by what type of hazard? So then you have a simple estimation based on either how the wind blows or maybe your gut feeling, and maybe you left it totally empty. Then we don't have types of loss events as an input. The next thing we are going to look into are the types of threat actors. You beautifully inventorize the potential threat actors per asset, and that is put down in our asset threat actors matrix. So what are we going to do? Out of our scoring spreadsheets, we take our asset crimes matrix, our asset hazards matrix, and our asset threat actors matrix. And we are going through the steps, first the crimes, then the hazards, then the threat actors, and we have to go to the result. We have to make an asset threat variables matrix. First, I'll show you how you create this output matrix, and then we are going to do it. So the processing, how to create this new matrix, list all assets as rows, copy paste, and the scores of all the threat consideration as columns. That's the first thing we have to do. Then, after you have done that, you have to look into the different rows, summarize all the values in the rows, and put the average in the score column. And then, after summarizing, you look into the score column and you are trying to rank them based on the average values. So, ladies and gentlemen, take your spreadsheets. We need the assets crimes we need the asset crimes, the asset hazards, and the asset threat actors. They are all in the same matrix. This one, yes. Because we did finalize the risk identification by this scoring part, we now have crimes, hazards, and threat actors in one matrix called the asset relationships matrix. So instead of pulling out of a folder three separate matrices, we can simply take the B1 asset relations scores matrix you made, and then it should be like this. The four classes of assets and the four classes of crimes, and here should be numbers in your situation, and the numbers you have summarized it and then calculated the average. So this column should be filled with numbers. The thing you are going to do is use this part for scoring the average and ranking for the position. Is there a pair in this classroom that says, well, We did the best job we could, and we uploaded a marvelous scoring matrix, asset relationships, that I can take as an example. And don't all together, I only need one, at least. Who dares?
I did it, but I think I got the position wrong.
Okay, so you, Cyril.
Yeah.
I'll take a look. Sec 2? Yeah. Ah, it's a RAR, and I think this beautiful. I'll think if, I'll look if it's possible. You know, it's not on this bloody computer. Anybody else who did either a zip or? Let me see. Anybody else who dares?
Yeah, we can upload ours.
Okay, then I have to change to
IFSEC
1. Only 8. It's also raw.
Yes, it is.
Yes. So
wasn't that in?
Well, this computer has problems because it hasn't have the program on it to.
Okay.
He can only use a zip and a direct.
Okay, but do you want us to upload documents in RAR or no?
Well, RAR is okay with me.
Arno asked us to do it, so that's why I
didn't. No, RAR is okay, it's fine. But normally I would download it and then on my own computer I have the software available. But on this standard computer. It's so I'm going to look for something that might be easy. So I see Alex. Okay. Alex? Which one should I? This one? The asset relationship, that's the right one?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's see what we get. Okay, this is not the scoring part. Yes, I think so. This one. Okay. All right, this one. I should have this one. Scores. Yes. Okay, this is a very simple one. I think, Alex, if you can explain why I only see once.
We didn't think it was important enough for a mining company, so we got once.
Okay, and I see here some more. Okay, here's some trees. Okay, it's probably with your hazards the same, yes? The threat agents, the threat actors are not as many. More. Okay. So if you, okay. If you look at the bottom line, it's all ones. Something more, and this is something more. So you sit, you are mainly scoring higher in the economic crimes and in the subversive acts. Okay. So what you have to do is we have to build a new matrix called the asset threat variables matrix. So the best thing you can do is get your own asset relationship scores matrix in front of you. So open it. And after you have opened it, please do save it with the name B2, because we are performing a risk analysis. B2 1 and then asset threat variables matrix. That should be the name. So I'll try it for, it's a protected view. So first I have to make it a view. Then I'll put, I can't save it because it's protected. So Alex, pull up your own asset relationships matrix so that you can see what I do. I'll save it as well, it's your spreadsheet, not mine. P2, risk analysis. Step 1. It's, you should call it asset threat variables. Variables matrix. And then 1V. Yeah, so up your asset relationships matrix with the scores. After you have opened it, save it as P2_1_ asset threat variables matrix and save it. Then you should see at the top of your spreadsheet that the name has changed and that you now have a copy of the three elements we need. We need the asset crimes, we need the asset hazards, and we needed the asset threat actors. So what we don't need is this the asset thread attacks. So I simply can do two things, either hide this page or delete it. Now I only have the threat actors, the hazards, and the crimes left. Okay, everybody performed it so far? Because I deleted the asset threat attacks, it's best to save again. Then we are going to the next step. We now created the new matrix with the new name called B21 asset threat variables matrix. We should have all assets as rows. That was marvelous because Alex completed it with the assets on the left hand side. So the assets are the rows and the scores of all the threat consideration as columns we've now. But now we have to do the summarizing, and after the summarizing, calculate the average in the score column. So I'm going back to this new created. Okay. What you see is our asset as rows, and we are mainly interested in the values that are in this column. So what you need to do, is copy the final two columns and paste it with a blank column next to it. Now I'm going to enlarge it. So simply copy, and I'll make it look some more neat. What you now have to do is establish the average values or the column number. This is Y, 6 until 12. So we have a J6. We look into the next average column, that's the O, 6. Where's the next? AE, 6. And then there should be the subversives, that's in AL. So we have 4 columns, and now we have to calculate this. So your beautifully equipped let's see how we do it. J6 plus, excuse me, first like this, J6 plus O6 plus AE6 plus AL 6 4. And then we have to have a look if all his no.
You need to put the equal sign and then average and then
come on. Do it.
Is it easier to take the original Excel sheet and get the average from there without the
no, you have to do it in this new matrix.
Yeah, but you can copy it over.
You can copy it over if you have already done it. I don't know if you have a calculation. There was a exact value in your cell I was copying. So if you have a calculation in J6, then you can copy first that calculation formula into the new added column and then just add the extra cells you want to. But in your column, there was only a right value. Marvelous. So, now we have... this can be right, 4.5. You have to add four values, these ones, and then divide it by four.
You need to replace the plus sign for the duplicate.
It's now calculating G6 plus 06, which counts up to 4.5, and then it takes the average of 1, 4.5, so it's 4.5.
You need to use commas instead of pluses.
Well, first try the chromata, and then if that doesn't work. Okay. Well, that's more like it. Okay, now we have the right formula. Simply copy and paste. And if you did copy paste, just check if it changed all the sixes into sevens. That's okay. Then I copy this 1, 2. The next. And the next, and the next. Okay, everybody managed to put the right formula into the newly added average column. Now you have your average value per asset calculated over the four types of crimes, the four classes of crimes. Now we have to according to the spreadsheet, we did now calculate after summarizing the average. Now we should establish the relative position based on the average scores in the rank column. So we added the new rank column and we have to look what is the highest and what is the lowest rank. Because we have so many ones, we simply can see that this value and this value over here are, well, like sky high. This is lower. So if you would, this would be the first position and this would be the second position. And all the rest would be the third position. If you want to, you're far more convenient with this stuff as I am, I think. So you can also calculate the rank. So the highest rank is the number one position, peer position, pole position. Then you get the rank number two, number three, number five, and you could have more asset rows having the same rank. So we now see that based on the asset crimes, this one. Excuse me, this one. And this one. So we have, then you can look what this red one is. I guess it will be the senior executives with Alex. They are have the highest score if you look at the crimes. And then we have this yellow part. If we go to the left, secret formulas and patents. So now you have seen how to perform at, copy the last two columns with the score and the rank into two new columns, then calculate the average values, summarize, divide it through four, and then you have your average score. And then what's the position amongst each other. What we are going to do is now have a short break, and after the break you are going to perform the same calculation but then for the asset hazards and then for the asset threat actors, so that you completed the threat variables. Okay? I think you need about, shall we combine having a break and doing the two extra, the hazard and the asset threat actors in once, and take a time when we sit together and go again? No, first have a break. 10 minutes break, so be back at 45 or 50 minutes to 3. Then we can start with the calculation for the hazards and the threat actors. it's convenient, dear students, you can, because I was working in the asset hazards matrix from Alex, I went to the title part, I did a copy, and I put it on top of the newly added columns. I reduced the font type and I gave it a bold line, so I can easily see now what the situation is for the asset hazards. And if it's even more convenient for you for future use, you could do that for the same position for your asset crimes and then your asset threat actors. So the principle you've seen, go to your spreadsheet, find the right cells for every single average score, add them, calculate the average, and after you've done the average, you have to look what the position in ranking is among all the stuff. So now you have time to make your asset crimes, your asset hazards, and your asset threat actors ready for the next stage.
Thank you.
de tafel.
Een laatste vraag. Sinds de user scores, de essence threat attacks, motive opportunity means. Hoort dat er ook bij?
Ja, dat is je target. Nee, dit is, je zit nu in de, volgens mij, de threat attacks. Yeah. Nee, het gaat nu alleen even. Nee, dus. Oh, je hebt geen nieuwe aangemaakt.
Nee, deze ga ik opslaan als een andere.
Oké. Dus dat betekent dat je voor het vaststellen van de threat for variables alleen de crimes, de hazards en de threat actors.
Oh, deze
ook. Die komt zo meteen, maar die moet je met een andere vergelijken. Maar als je tijd over hebt, mag je het trucje van optellen wel doen binnen de threat attacks spreadsheet.
Oké.
Als het goed is, zou je is er een functie voor de relatieve positie te bepalen op basis van de waarde die hierin staat. Maar ik ben ook niet zo erg.
Ja, ik weet hem toevallig wel.
Oké. Als hem even. Moet ik even naar een andere toe, naar deze?
Ja, dat is hier.
Ga je gang. Kijk, op basis van de average zeker. Van.
Er zit hier een dollar voor dat hij niet meeschuift als je hem kopieert.
Dus dan gaan we even kijken. Dit is nog steeds een rode gebleven dan. Dat klopte. Dat klopt dus ook nog steeds. Er zijn geen tweetjes bijgekomen. Nou, dit was natuurlijk relatief simpel. Maar zometeen krijgen we een hele ingewikkelde. Dus geweldig dat je. If you are almost ready, and thanks to Eva, there was the more convenient way to establish the position in the ranking. This is the formula. So you can simply put it into, we did it now manually. But it's equals rank dot EQ, and then between brackets from where to start. We were happy that we got the same results, so I highlighted the number one with red and the number two with yellow. It was quite simple by this spreadsheet because we only had 1, 2, and 3 as value, but if you have more different values, then it could be very convenient. And I'll have to do the final spreadsheet for Alex. Okay guys, did everybody do the introduction of the average column and the ranking column in the three different spreadsheets? Asset crimes, asset hazards, and asset threat actors. What you could do to make it more simple for an overview is copy copy the A column into a new one, then you go to the just made columns. Where is my sheet 4? No, sheet 3? No, sheet 2? Ah, here it is. You can make one summary sheet simply doing like this, or what you can do is my sheets are asset hazards. Okay. What you can also do, if that's more convenient for you, hide. This one I need, don't need. Delete. 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 As a threat actors. Oops. Right. I already hit them. Delete. And the asset crimes. Yes. And right. And don't forget to save. So now we have for three variables, crimes, hazards, and threat actors, the average score and the rank in position. We saved it, and now we are going back to the next step. We are calculating the probability factor. And the first thing we had to look into were the threat variables. Those are ready. Now we have to go and take a look into the target selection variables. Remember, in the spreadsheet I showed you with the relationship scores, I made a copy under the new name, and from the four items available, I kept three and I threw away the asset threat attacks. So what we now have to do is look into, for our threat target value, we have to look into what is of particular interest for a threat actor or agent when it comes to the target, the asset as a target value. Then we are going to look into the asset threat attacks matrix, and then we are going to look into the attractiveness, and the easier it is to undertake surveillance of an asset, the more likely it is that the threat actor will choose it as a target. And the more vulnerable an asset is, the nicer it will be for a threat agent to perform an attack on. So we are going to look into the target selection variables. At the same way, our input, like you see, is the asset threat attacks matrix. So get your asset relationship scoring spreadsheets ready on screen, and you had your asset scoring matrix, that one we also need. It's a threefold action. First, potential target value per asset, then surveillance opportunities, and then vulnerability. And we're going to create a new spreadsheet called the asset target selection variables matrix. And that's quite a long name. Creation, same way. What we are going to do is put this one away. I think I got, yes, I had this one. I open it again. Now I have the same original from Alex. I have to enable editing. I have to save it as P2.1. Caps lock on target, selection, oh, the variables are not there, oops. Okay, we saw out of the spreadsheet, out of the to-do list that we need the asset thread attacks. So I need the thread attacks. So what I'm going to do is throw away all the other stuff. So clear out the asset crimes part, clear out the asset hazards part, and clear out the asset threat agents part. Now we only have our asset threat attacks left. And you are going to perform it the same way. Alex didn't do the scoring per item. So you should have had a score for the target. You should have had a score for the violent attacks and for the pretty attacks and so on and so on. So you have to add an extra column.
For the ranks and I'm pretty sure that did
I took your okay. I have to log in again because I waited too long. Well, if you have no problems, then you and you did your scoring, you should have per class an average column and a rank column. So you can start doing what you did with the thread variables. Add at the end of the spreadsheet two extra columns and do the calculation like we started to work on. Let's see if it was the IPSEC 2. And then we had I took your relationships asset relations course. This one, open. And we need the thread attacks. This is a better one. Read only, save as. One asset variables. Okay, I'm throwing away the crimes, delete. I'm throwing away the hazards. And before I throw away the threat actors, yes, I need the threat attacks. So this one I can delete, yes. Okay, I'll save this one. Okay, the principle is clear that you the same way add two extra columns or copy paste this column and then over there, but you can also use the already made with the formula for the ranking over here. And then I have the same problem over here. I have to change this, and that is going to be the B6. C6, D6. And to copy paste everything. And this one. Okay. then I have to go from H into N. Finally, this one, it's the R6 until the V6. And finally, this one, and then I go to AGAN. Thank you. So if you did the proper actions, you should have your asset threat attacks rearranged, and you could have something like this as first part of your asset target selection. Everybody managed to do this part? Never mind the scoring over here, because it's all based on what Alex put into the columns, but it's the principle. Okay. Now, we did, based on our... We just calculated based on the asset threat attacks matrix the target value. Now we have two more left, the surveillance opportunities and the vulnerability per asset, and that's our source, the asset vulnerabilities matrix. So what you need is your asset scores. So I'm going to look asset scores from Alex. I'm going to open that. There's more numbers. Okay, what do we need? We need, out of this matrix, our surveillance opportunities and our vulnerabilities. Yep. So, we have our asset score, so we don't need the criticality column. We don't need the consequences. We only need the vulnerabilities. You know, these are the surveillance opportunities. And what's left? Accessibility. The intrinsic vulnerabilities and the subtracted existing and so on and so on. So what we are going to do, we are going to copy this part, and if you don't dare to, you can simply save it under another name. Oh, I'm not, I can't, okay, first I have to go back, enable editing, file, save, and I'm going to make it a B2-1. Asset if you call it target selection, and it's target selection variables, but you have a problem because you then you have a duplication. So for the moment I will name it asset vulnerabilities. Hmm? Then I can play with it. I make it myself easy. I do a hide. You simply do the same copy pasting and checking if everything is all right. This is N6 to yes, that's okay. And this is the Q6 AC6. You don't need this one. This should be the same. Did you do the right calculation, Alex? Did you subtract the countermeasures?
Probably not.
Probably not. Okay, time for a break. 10 minutes enough, or do you need a quarter?
No, 10 minutes.
10 minutes enough. Okay, 45. We'll start again. I'll have a save. Is this a better way now? Doing it step by step, your own with your own spreadsheet. Because I can show it, but now you have to do it by yourself, and that's not quite easy. Okay, only the diehards are left for the final spurt towards the finish. The back rows are totally empty. I saw them leaving. I wish them good luck with the homework assignment. We were stuck with the vulnerabilities, and I mentioned to the Alex, because I use his spreadsheet, if he did the right calculation. So I'll have to show you the asset scores. If you, I can easily use his one. If you have the accessibility plus the columns for surveillance opportunities plus the intrinsic vulnerabilities, so 1 and 2 and 3 all together, they make out the vulnerability value. And if you have something on existing natural countermeasures, 4, and existing physical, electronic or operational countermeasures, then you have to subtract the values of column 4 and 5. So add up 1, 2 and 3. And then you have a value, you've got to subtract the countermeasures from it. And that will make your average. So first I think you have to do your recalculation. Add up the columns 1 until 3. And from that value, subtract 4 and 5. And then you get your right average score. So that should be This one, and that's column. Should be the W set. There's something wrong in the formula. You should add up 1, accessibility, 2, surveillance opportunities, plus 3, intrinsic vulnerabilities. That then you have your positive vulnerability value, and your vulnerability is influenced by the existing countermeasures, either natural or man-made. So you have to subtract the values of 4, through 5 from the sum. And I tried to do it, but the formula is not all right. So you have to at least do the sum of the blue ones. Then you have to subtract the values of this one. That's nice when you have to use a formula you normally do not use. If you use the basic ones, yes, this one is better. So what you can do is sum up accessibility, surveillance opportunities and the intrinsic vulnerabilities, then subtract the sum of all the countermeasures, and the value you get, you divide by 13, that's the number of columns. And if you do that, then you have to write value. So I have to copy and paste. This formula. And the final one. And then I have to look into this one. This should be the same. So the positioning part, I can go to the where is the wait a minute. Where did I leave my Alex's spreadsheets? Oh, I know where it is. It's over here. It's already open. Okay. So I copy this formula, I was in this, I paste it. So this is the AA6, yes, okay, copy. 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 And copy. Okay. So you could do the same thing. I have now hidden all the vulnerability columns. I already hid the criticalities and the consequences. So I've now calculated the score, average, and the rank for the vulnerabilities. Everybody got so far? What did you say?
Negative?
A negative value?
Yeah.
That's not possible. It's possible. If you have a lot of existing countermeasures with greater value than the accessibility and the surveillance opportunities and the intrinsic vulnerabilities together, you could have a negative value. So only within the vulnerability scoring there could be a negative value. And if it's below zero, then it's it should have a high rank in the position column, because it's less vulnerable as the other ones. So this is the only possibility where you can have a negative value. So I can't see what is happening, because I don't know which values, which scores you have noted into the columns. I simply use Alex's example all the time. So George, it's very okay with negative value in this. Then you should have in this column somewhere negative values, and that should be the lowest rank. Is that correct in your spreadsheet? Then you did a marvelous job. Okay. So what did we do? We performed the threat variables, then the target selection variables. We have now two things. We created the asset target selection variables matrix. See what I told you. Well, accessibility, surveillance opportunity, and intrinsic vulnerability summarize, and existing natural man-made subtracted. That is what we just did. And then the same procedure as the last time. Okay, we have now two components based on crimes, hazards, and threat actors, and the second component is based on the target value. Now we have to estimate the result, because we are calculating the probability factor. So we have our input. Based on the threat variables, we created our asset threat variables matrix, where we did our first scoring, ranking, and so on. We created the second one, the asset target selection variables matrix. And now we are almost ready to do the probability estimation. We decided that we renamed the target value as a target selection variable, and we put the surveillance opportunities and the vulnerability per asset in a separate spreadsheet. So we have to remember, because we took an extra help step, to combine not two, but three spreadsheets. So what are we going to do? To estimate the probability, we take our first asset threat variables matrix, our second asset target selection variables matrix, and our sneaky created asset vulnerabilities matrix, and now we are going to sum up, as you can say, those scores into a probability summary matrix. Okay, there we go. How are we going to create it? You can pick what you want to. You can pick your asset threat variables matrix or your asset selection variables matrix. One or two of two is okay. It doesn't matter which one you choose. Open it and then save it under the new name, the probability summary matrix. So that's the first thing we have to do. What I'm going to do is take, we had our asset target selection. We had our asset threat variables. And we had our extra sneaky asset vulnerabilities. I pick one that has the most convenient part. For example, I choose the asset threat attacks. Now, I'm going to save it as should be in caps, probability factor. Oops. We have to combine the scores of our 2.5 separate spreadsheets into one probability summary. So I have to now, you can have one problem, because all these values are calculated based on what's on columns now hidden. So you have to find a way to fix the value. And I thought there was a great Excel specialist, expert in the room, who's now looking into his mobile phone. Eva is coming. Ja, dus wat er gedaan moet worden is, als het ware, de waarden die in deze kolommen staan, vast te zetten. Kan je dat?
Ja. Juist. Alleen de values.
Ja, precies. Oké. En dat heb je, ik kan ze nu gewoon kopiëren naar die andere. I trust Eva. So I copy the asset crimes into I'm going to this one, the hazards. Can I do this the same, Eva, or do I have to do? Nog een keer?
Kopiëren eerst.
Ja. Yeah.
Dan onder paste, dat zijn mee.
Nu je de muis doet, dan plakken en dan.
Onder?
Onder, gewoon erop, zeg maar.
Ja. Yeah.
En dan met 1, 2, 3
ernaast. Ah, deze. Ja. Super. Copy. En dan gaan we this one. Okay. Then I have now the crimes the hazards, the threat actors were already there because I took the easiest way. So I have to rearrange it because the assets come first and then I insert it, insert the column. Okay, now I have my asset crimes, I have my asset hazards, I have my asset threat attacks, all nicely combined with the rows. I have my vulnerabilities, I have to put in a title, vulnerabilities, okay. I bold it up. It's too large. I have to put it over here. Okay. Let's check if we have everything. We should have the threat variables that was composed of target value, surveillance, yep. And the other one was crimes, hazards, threat actors. I think we only missed the... crimes, threat attacks. What were we missing? The target value. Okay. Yeah. The threat actors we are missing. I thought we were not complete, and that's correct. So I have this one. It's already open. Yes. And I have to rename it because it was not so nicely done. I don't know if I saved this. probability summary. Excuse me, matrix. Up. So as a result of all our doing, we now have our summary for the probability composed of the asset threat actors, the asset crimes, the asset hazards, the asset threat attacks, and the vulnerabilities. And now you have to do the magic. We have our probability summary matrix. Now we have to do our estimation. We have all the assets as rows and the scores of all the underlying matrices with scores positions. Now all the rows should be summarized and averaged into the score column and positioned in the rank column. So your job is to go to this newly created probability summary matrix. What you have to do is, the best one is this. Copy, not the vulnerabilities stuff, because there's a subtraction. Okay, so now we have this copied. We change the name. Probability. One, two, three, four, factor. Okay, we've got it. What you have to do first, if you have colored ones, put everything first on no color at all. Then you have to count for the overall probability average score. So you have to look over here. Into your spreadsheet for the right cells that you're going to need. So I need the, in my case, the AS. Then I need the AV. So you take all the scores, the average columns per series. This is the AY. This is the BB. This is the BA. And we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's okay. So now I'm going to average AS. AV. AY. The BB. And after the BB, I need the BE. And then we have a problem. Let's see what the problem is. AS, BB. he should do it, but he doesn't. Row numbers, yes. And this one. Okay. BH. Okay, let's look for copy and do the pasting. Just to be sure that we didn't miss anything. And over here. And over here. Yes. Okay, now let's look for... This is number... Excuse me, this is the number one, this is the number two, there is something wrong. Position AQ BH 6, yes, yes, okay. So if you do your calculation for your probability factor, then this column is the first factor that we calculated. I'm going to show you the next steps. They are all on the same procedure. I will save this one, so I'm not going to take you through all the steps. I'll simply explain what you can do. You know now how you can come from your basic risk data to the first factor. The next step is the same, but then we are going to establish the vulnerability factor. Therefore, we take our adversary means matrix. That's the one that you created for the threat scenarios. It's in the threat agents matrix. Then you have the same one, the asset threat actors you use and the vulnerabilities. So here's your input. Remember that you have to look for your adversary means matrix that's in your threat agent agents matrix. We used in the relationship our threat actors, and we just had made our vulnerabilities matrix, and we need to use the surveillance opportunities and vulnerability again. So our extra spreadsheet in between that we created, we can use. So these are the steps. You create a vulnerability summary matrix like you did for the probability summary matrix. And the last factor you have to calculate for is the consequences factor. Same way, only you use now your asset matrix where you have your criticalities and your consequences. We didn't use it yet. So your input is your criticalities. You get to produce your consequences summary matrix. And now, if you have done the same procedure for your vulnerability and your consequences, we have the three separate factors. Those three factors are deciding what risk we have for this organization in question. But we only have now the three separate factors, each for its own situation with its average score and its ranking for probability, or if you do the next two steps for your vulnerability and your consequences. But we have to, before we can really establish, determine the level of risk, we have to prioritize what risks are more important in comparison to other risks. You do this like two steps. Look at the steps, try to understand them. We have three separate factors. We are now going to combine the probability factor we take out, we take the vulnerability factor out, and we take the consequences factor out, and we put them into a new spreadsheet. Only put into it and not ranked yet. So, we made together our probability summary matrix. You have to make your vulnerability summary and your consequences summary matrix the same way as the probability summary matrix was produced. And now we are going to process the risks without ranking. So they are, as you could say, unsorted. How do we do? New matrix, assets on the left-hand side as rows, and then you put your three factors next to each other. And each factor has two columns. Each factor has an average column and a position column. So in total, three factors, six columns, two columns per factor. Okay. After you put your three factors with each two columns into the new unsorted risk matrix you are going to create, you have to decide, either by yourself or after you have talked to the organization, what are you going to use to prioritize the risks? Well, to help you, there are a lot of possibilities or criteria to use how you can rank your risk. I won't go deep into. You can do it simple by formula. I will show you that. You can take probability as your main criterion, or the criticality, or the consequences, or the cost. What I have seen in practice is, please don't use prioritization by cost. Then you are only looking for the money. That what is cheapest, that is going to be chosen first by the management of the organization. So that's not recommended. What I recommend is prioritize by consequences. Because if you lose something, one of your assets, then it's directly influencing the mission of your organization. So we choose four, prioritization by consequences. If you have your unsorted risk matrix with 3x2 columns, the probability, vulnerability, and the consequences, your risks are unranked, unsorted, and now we are going to rank them, sort them, or better said, we are going to prioritize by consequences. And the result, after you have reordered them, creates a new matrix, a sorted risk matrix. And finally, you are going to visualize the risk that you have prioritized. I will show you how it could look like. I have to explain, risk should be calculated. So we have now our probability, our vulnerability, and our consequences. You can use the upper formula, simply probability times vulnerability times consequences, but then you get big numbers. And in order to stay the numbers in the same range, the best and the simplest form is add the three factors, so probability plus vulnerability plus consequences, and the sum you get divided by three. So we are going to use the simple form. This formula is going to be used. So remember, you have to put in your spreadsheets, in your final calculation, P plus V plus C divided by 3. Okay, I'll show you how it looks like. A random example. We have calculated them. I told you, you have your three factors, but we are only going to look at the average scores. You probably have the rank column for the probability next to it, but you have to use the score column for the calculation. So what you are going to do is, per row, add up the average score for probability plus the average score for vulnerability plus the average score for consequences, divided by 3, and then you have a broken number, and you can round it, either it comes a higher number or it becomes a lower number, depending on where the break is. Okay, now this is your calculation. But now we have to prioritize, so we have to look into the consequences column. So these values you have calculated should now be ranked according to the consequences column. Until now we did the ranking by the average column, but in your final calculation where you need to establish your risk values, you do after the normal calculation, you're going to rank based on the consequences, because we decided to prioritize by consequences. We're nearly there. Management wouldn't easy read this stuff. Yes, if you are a manager that had the same educational program as you, probably it will. But a manager of this times wants to see it in a picture, so you have to visualize it. You're going to do this like this. You simply create a summary matrix, a risk summary matrix, and then you have the probability set out towards the vulnerability and the consequences in between. It looks like this. This is your probability factor, this is your vulnerability factor, and that what is the result of your ranking or prioritization by consequences will come into the cells. Remember, we had score possibilities 1, 3, 5, 8, and 10. If you now had chosen another formula than the simple one, add up, divide by 3, you had big numbers. Then you had to adapt the ranges for low, medium, high. So you can simply say every result you have that comes from null, nil, 1, 2, 3 is considered low. Every resulting value is 4, 5, 6, or 7 is considered to be medium. And if you have an 8, a 9, or a 10 as final value, then it's considered high. So the trick. This should be your final result. You know you are going to calculate your PVC, ranked by consequences. This ranking by consequences this one, the prioritized risks, you're going to put into the cells of this picture. Remember, based on the prioritization by consequences, you put those assets with a low probability and a low vulnerability into the cell on the left hand side. So what you have left is fill these cells with those assets with a low P or high V, medium P, high V. I gave the colors either a straight font or I took italic. What's italic? Oh, excuse me. What's italic is high vulnerability, high vulnerability, high vulnerability. The more vulnerable your result is, the higher the risk and the more necessary it will be to think about countermeasures in the next stage when we do the risk evaluation. So now we have simply plotted and depending on the risk culture of your organization, also called the risk appetite, do they want no risk at all left, then everything should be italic? Does the management only because of the risk culture and the risk appetite tackle the medium and high risks, or only the high risks? Well, normally, if you go and look into the real world, at least the high vulnerabilities and the medium vulnerabilities that have a medium probability and a high probability, those are holes that should be plugged by countermeasures. And if an organization can afford it, then the low P and the low V can be dealt with, can be accepted. So what you have to do, you see it here again, but now with values. What you have to do, I have to put that one out, and I have to put that one in. What you have seen in this visualization, low, medium, high, is the same what Stallings talks about, low, not medium, but he calls it moderate and high. And remember, whatever a level of impact you have, it's always a degradation in the capability to achieve your mission. That's number one, that shouldn't be at risk. Then the first asset that should be protected is the people asset. So the safety of people and the security of people is numero uno. You can't afford to have injuries or even worse. Then you have your other assets, your property, your information and your business reputation, and even then on the final part you can look at your financial losses. Well, depending on the level of impact, low, moderate or high, well, the damage is greater. So after this lesson, you know how to perform the risk analysis step. You finally know now how to assess the security risks after probability, vulnerability and the consequences factor. And when you have this visualization, this matrix, we have our basis for the next and final stage, the risk evaluation. Then we are going to look into, okay, now we know where the holes are, what are the most appropriate countermeasures depending on if it's low, medium or high PVC. The practical assignment. You did a great work already for the homework assignment. So the only thing you have to do is we went through all the steps for establishing the probability factor. Well, it's quite easy with copy-pasting to establish the vulnerability factor and the consequences factor. Then you have to prioritize it. I simply explained to you, copy-paste the results of the summary matrices, prioritize them and calculate the level of risk, add them, divide them by three and put it into a nice visualization. So what I want you to do is this as homework. What you want to deliver are at least you need to have the separate excels for the probability, for the vulnerability, and for the consequences. So that's three matrices. And then the next step, sorted, unsorted. Be aware that you save it in separate excels. If, as a pair, you want to do a rework of your former spreadsheets and or your former calculations, the scoring you did for your assets and the scoring you did for your relationships, then it's okay with me. Then if you send it, then it will be more than only the Excel documents for the risk analysis you deliver on Monday, next coming Monday. If you want to do a redo, then I'll do a regrading of the spreadsheet you already delivered. It's your choice, it's no obligation. The only obligation in concern to your homework assignment is do the risk analysis. Lecture 7, our next and final lecture, upcoming Monday. Please read the book 19, it's about law and ethics and so on. Just read it. Perform the assessment number 6, same procedure as always. And if you have any questions on your research topic after the tutoring lesson of upcoming Thursday, you can always put them into a Word document and put them as questions in the assignment folder on the VLO. Questions for the moment? Well, your homework should be easy copy-pasting. If you were working with together with all the stuff during the lecture.